Hello, my name is Michael Garrick, and this is Popping Culture Movie Reviews. My guest today is comedian Brian O'Neill, very funny comedian. If he's in your city, please, please go support him. He'll keep you laughing. The movie that we'll be reviewing is Friday. This will be a 100% spoiler review, but before we spoil the movie, Brian, do you believe they should watch it?
Yes, I think everyone should watch the movie Friday. I think it is culturally relevant. American society, Black American society, yes.
Nice. I totally agree, guys. You should definitely watch it. If you do not want to buy it, it should be on USA Network this weekend.
Oh, really?
It's on there a lot. It's on there so much. I don't know what deal New Line has, but they have a great deal with USA Network.
They played it on like, they had it on my plane that I took to Africa. Like, it was like, you could watch Friday. They didn't have the other ones, just the original, which is the best one, in my opinion.
Oh, I agree. They were just like, oh, we'll stick with Chris Rock. We'll choose Mike Epps some other time.
Right. Hell yeah.
So, of course, I've seen this movie 100 times. I'm sure you have too.
Yeah.
What at this time period, for people that don't know or they're watching, listening, that don't know, can you explain to them how big Ice Cube was at this time?
So I'm imagining that this is like right after NWA, like for the most part. Like I think this is like once he left NWA, I think maybe he was still rapping with like some like group in New York or something like that. And this movie was kind of like made during that like transition of him like being a rapper to like being a, you know, the writer that he is and making a movie. And so it was a low budget movie. You know, people didn't get paid much to be in the movie, but it birthed like some of the best comedic stars that we've seen, you know, from the Black community, like so many stars, like it's ridiculous. Yes. But yeah, that was Ice Cube's time of like transitioning, in my opinion.
Yes. There's so many great comedians in this movie also. Yeah. So many great comedians.
Star studded. And the thing is like, the movie was hilarious with all of them in it, but like it wasn't until later when you go back and look, you're like, damn, like Bernie Mac was in there. You know what I mean? Like all these like big names, Chris Tucker, you know, Chris Tucker after that movie, he goes on, he's making $20 million a movie with Rush Hour. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, making millions, crazy. Not paying taxes, just living life.
Him and Wesley Snipes got the same tax person, apparently.
Yes. I don't know about for you, but this movie was when I first got a crush on Kyla Pratt.
Yes. Yes. I always had a crush on Kyla Pratt. Yes. But was she, I think that was Megan Good though, wasn't it?
Megan Good. I apologize. Yeah. I mixed the names up. Megan Good. I'm sorry.
About to say, yeah, I had a crush on Kyla Pratt for sure. But yeah, Megan Good.
It was Megan Good, yes.
Yes, she was the cute chick in that movie for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, because it blew my mind because I was like, I know this girl from somewhere. Because the next time I saw her was in Cousin Skeeter.
Yes, and, yes, she was in Cousin Skeeter. Yes, I do recall that too.
Yes, yes. But to talk about the intro to this movie, why do you think it works so well?
So it's showing that, you know, it's morning time, it's Friday, right? They're kind of going through the house, showing the house, whatever. And then, like, the intro of, like, the Jehovah's Witness, like, knocking on your door, like, early in the morning on a Friday is, like, hilarious right there. And then the fact that the way the lady responds after he, like, shuts the door in his face, like, my family, like, just died laughing at, like, this Jehovah's Witness, like, cursing, cussing the fuck, like, out of this dude. Like, it's, like, a perfect beginning to the movie, like. Because the movie's like, it's laughs throughout the movie. Like, it's not like whatever, like, it's laughs throughout. So,
yes. And as an ex Jehovah's Witness myself, I know those sisters.
Oh, yeah. I did not know that they go hard like that because Kay's, my girlfriend's grandma, is like Jehovah's Witness. So,
yeah.
I know they can be. All right. So, I guess you're excommunicated and you're.
Disfellowship.
So do they talk to you? Because I thought they're not supposed to talk. No. Yeah, they're not talking.
I haven't talked
to
my
right?
family in 8 years. Yeah.
God damn. sorry to hear about that. I feel like getting deep now.
It's totally fine. Right. The funniest story I had was I did a show in Columbia. This is about 3 years ago. And I know Jehovah's Witness, they know my face, but I grew a bigger beard at that time, so I didn't look like myself. Like, if you look hard enough, you knew it was me. So I told the guy that was like, he was about to bring me up, and I was like, hey man, call me up as Lance Armstrong. And he was like, no, why don't you say your name? I was like, but if you say my name, you're gonna lose half this audience. I need you to say Lance Armstrong. But they, you know, I think some of them kind of caught on it was me, but they stayed.
Yeah. Oh, that's funny, man. Damn. Yeah, because like not to get off subject again, but I've been like, it's kind of like a cult, right? Like
my mom is still one, so I don't want to give like my feelings yet.
Oh, okay, got you. Sorry. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, like don't get me wrong, I'll pick on the religion, but like when it comes to like how I really feel, I know what I say will probably get back to her.
Gotcha.
I don't gotcha. Want to, you know.
Okay, yeah, definitely respect for the family and things like that. But no, I've heard of other excommunication style things. So
I'm not disagreeing with you, buddy.
Right. Yeah, I'm just saying, like, I don't know. That part to me, like, kind of seems a little culty, but, you know, that's just my opinion. You know, hi, mom. You know, love you.
Yeah. It'd be hilarious to find out she's watching. I'd be like, oh, that's the 1% in Winsboro, South Carolina. Like, this whole time she's been watching.
That's who it is. Yeah. She's been supporting. She can't talk to your ass, but she's supporting.
No. She's like, one day he's going to get that ad money. But do you think this movie is so successful because of how quotable it is?
I think so. There's a lot of moments in that movie that I quote to this day. Me and my family, like, that's way, like, we talk to each other in Friday, you know, phrases and stuff like that. So yeah, I mean, you think about it, when the dude was like, get knocked out like your father used to, you got knocked the fuck out, or like, you know what I mean, like, it's like so many, like Bernie Mac, Claude, have mercy, you know, the Lord is my shepherd, he know what I want, you know what I mean, like I could quote that entire movie of like, my grandmama gave me that chain, like I'm trying to think of like some other ones that was in there.
I can't wait to tell my son, you better pour some water on that shit.
Right? You better pour some water on that damn shit. It's so many, like, when he was like, I'm trying to think of like when Ice Cube was high and he was like, you ain't got no Kool-Aid, you ain't got no sugar, you got ham, no burger. It's like, classic line.
Yes. How'd you get fired on your day off? Which I've used so many times in my life. Fired? Like, bro, how'd you get fired on your day off? Day. Like, still in boxes.
When Stanley is telling him to get off the grass, and and Chris Tucker is like, Stanley be acting like old bitch sometimes. He's like, nothing but dirt any damn way. Oh man, Ezel, like, he's like, my neck and my back.
Have you seen him do stand up?
I have not.
He's funny. He's gonna be in Greenville next month, but like, I actually finally got to see him. Dude's hilarious, bro. Like,
yeah,
he's hilarious.
That's dope. Yeah, I knew he was a comedian, and I figured he did stand up, but I never like had seen like his stuff before because I don't think I've really seen him. He did Friday, and I know him from like I Got the Hookup.
Yeah,
and those are like those are the only two movies I really remember him being in.
Yeah, but anything over $2 million, he can't get into that movie. Too much of a
budget. Right. It's too much of a budget, or whatever. But he seemed like a funny dude. So
yeah, I definitely slept on him. But once I saw his stand up, I was like, oh, this guy's a heavy hitter.
There's a dude that came through Charlotte recently. He was in I Got the Hookup. So he played like the special needs guy that was like shooting at people. And I can't think of his name right now, but.
Oh, I know the face, yeah.
Yeah, he was in Charlotte for a little bit.
Nice. Yeah. Even Miss Parker, which she's not even in the movie a lot, but you just remember her, you know, just because she was a gorgeous woman.
Miss Parker, we used to do that shit. We had a teacher. And he's like, hey, Miss Parker. Hey, Miss Parker. I don't know, sure, she ever like knew what we were like quoting or doing. Yeah. But yeah, Miss Parker is definitely. I remember my mom like not wanting me to like see her, you know, how voluptuous she was.
She was one of those teachers your parents go like, it's a dress code somewhere here.
Exactly. Yeah. They have like a teacher in Atlanta apparently was called that like Teacher Bay, because she was pretty, she was thick and curvy. But she was wearing, you know, a dress. Like, that's what you wear at school. This shit just fit her like a glove. I'm like, God damn.
Yes, I remember that. I remember that. I was just like, if there's anybody that wants to stay over for detention, it's
Right, yeah, exactly, man. Like, yeah, they don't have teachers like that.
How'd you like the way they kept this movie set in just one day?
Yeah, so that's interesting because it does happen in one day, but it doesn't feel like it because so much is happening. And I know towards the end, they kind of speed up time so they can go to the shootout or whatever. But yeah, a good chunk of it was just spent like during the day, just them being on the stoop, kind of like shit happening, coming through, you know, Debo coming through, stuff like that. Like, so I like that because, yeah, it's based off a day, like it's called Friday. So it's based off of like happening that Friday. And I love that part of it. And I think that's what makes it like so special of like a regular day in the hood, but like this is all the shit that happens. Like dog catcher, bit dad's ass, like all kinds of shit, you know.
Yes. Do you like the fact that they made Debo the bigger villain? Because they could have easily kept Faison Love's character, Big Worm, as the villain, but do you like them just substituting Debo towards the end?
I think it was a good mixture of both because obviously with Faison Love, that character was like more dangerous as far as like, he's going to kill you. Right. Sorry, my dog's like making noises back here. But then Debo's kind of like the bully in the area and he's like hitting women and like just being, you know, taking people's like chain and money and stuff like that. So when he like hits his love interest and Ice Cube sees this and kind of goes off. Like to me, like that's like the perfect matchup of like, all right, we got out of, you know, Faison Love's character. We've like eluded that, but now you're like faced with like, now I got to stop Debo from like being the piece of shit that he's been being to people. And so that showdown is like, you know,
yeah,
prime. Like, you know what I mean? Like it was great. I like quote stuff like, come on, Craig. Come on, Craig. Like, yes. Yes. Like he's not fighting fair.
Yes. And that brick is like,
oh, man. He slang that brick at his ass like, pow. Yes. Like, yeah. He was pretty accurate with that brick. That was far away. Like, yes.
Like... yeah. That's one of the deleted scenes. You just see him throwing bricks.
yeah, exactly. Just trying to get it right. Like, hell yeah.
How much does this soundtrack go into this movie being successful?
So the thing is, I don't think I was listening to like a lot of rap music during that time as a kid. Cause I didn't really start getting to rap until like Jay-Z, like Hard Knock Life kind of thing. But I do recall like hearing those songs at the end of the movie, just thinking like, yeah, this seems like, you know, Ice Cube made these records or whatever. So like, I don't know. I thought it was dope, but I didn't understand how important it was to the movie just because I wasn't listening to hip hop that much during that time.
Okay. Yeah. You spoke about the movie rushing at the end to finish. I completely agree. But when it comes to the pacing, is there any scene in this movie that you would have took out?
I mean, maybe the scene where Ice Cube is like arguing with his girlfriend on the phone about, you know, him going to the show last night or something like that with somebody. Because what's funny is like, if you pay attention to that scene, there's a guy in the bed with her, like in the background. And it looks like Smokey, honestly, because it's like, he's wearing blue or like whatever and got khakis. Like, it feel like it could be Smokey. But like she's got a guy in the bed next to her while she's like, you know, yelling at him of being with someone.
Yeah.
So I would take that out.
I completely agree. But like, besides that, this movie is like very, very well done. To speak one more time on the cameos, did you have a favorite cameo?
Favorite cameo. I mean, I think Red getting his chain snatchers is like priceless. Like, to me, you got to have that in the movie. And I love that. And I love the Bernie Mac. Like, you know, that might have been one of my first introductions to Bernie Mac because, you know, my mom didn't let me watch Def Comedy Jam. So I didn't quite know him as a stand up act until like the Kings of Comedy. But so that was really cool to see like the beginnings of like, oh shit, like Bernie Mac's like, he's here and he's funny as fuck. And, you know, he's funny. But then when you see Kings of Comedy, you're like, God damn, like, that's one of the best performances, like, you know, I've seen in, like, such a long time, you know?
Yeah. When you see, I didn't mean to cut you off, but when you see Kings of Comedy, it's just amazing to know when they started this tour, he was the opening act. Like, that.
Oh, really?
I mean, shortly realized like who wants to work this hard every night who wants to go after this every night, nobody wants to go after this, so that didn't last long at all.
Yeah, and that just shows just how fucking funny he is, man. Like, he was just the way he said things, it was more like how the way he said things, and like, I don't know, it just felt like Black people just related to him, like, so much. Like, I remember just, like, being with my parents, and we all just felt like he was, like, our cousin or something like that, just, like, talking shit or whatever. Yes. Like, it was great.
He always had that, my uncle that I wanted to see. He always,
that's right, like, yeah, exactly. You want to hear what your uncle's going to say kind of vibe. Yeah, exactly. And that's who he was, man. And it was hilarious and sad that he's not around anymore. But man, like, he left behind a good body of work, man.
Yes.
For real.
Yes. When it comes to Smokey's character, can you see anybody but Chris Tucker playing him?
The actual character, no. Like, I can't see anyone else playing that because it's so based off of like how his comedy was back then, like his stand-up, like it was all based off of like this, I don't know, this like really funny guy that don't have his shit together, but it's like funny, you know what I mean? Like, it's just like he's a fool or whatever, like, and that kind of matched at that time Chris Tucker's vibe. Now, I think as he went through like Rush Hour and stuff, he stayed with that, but you know, he got a little bit more like serious, in my opinion, or like just more into the acting part, which is cool. But I mean, he killed that role as far as like what you were looking for. And don't get me wrong, like Mike Epps is hilarious in his own way as Day Day and all that. But you know, that Chris Tucker vibe was real, like being Smokey. And it sucked that he didn't do the movies anymore after that, because he was just getting paid to do other stuff or whatever. But
it's one of those things that once you hear Chris Tucker say it and you're like, man, I went from 30,000 to 10 million, 20 million. It's really hard to go back to a, you know, like, you know, a lot of comedians. Thousand. Yeah. Like a lot of comedians like to go back and do like indie work or passion projects, but it's kind of hard, man. Like I haven't made my first million yet, but I can't imagine like making a million and then trying to,
back to like doing like open mics or whatever. Like, I don't know, like doing a showcase where it's like, oh, get $20 or $10. He's like, you know, you'll be like, I just got paid, you know, 600, 800, whatever, how much you would make the headline a night or something. You know, probably way more than that if you're, you know, making millions. But it's just like, true. You know, it's already like, oh, just come back to Columbia and whatever. It's like, if you come back to Columbia and do a show like that, it might as well be like for like a nonprofit or some shit. You know what I mean? Like, it's not like necessarily, you know what I mean? It would be more of a charitable thing. And
I can see coming back just because I know the few people that did come back, they just do door deals. So the comedy house will get all the food, all the alcohol. But if you charge $25 at the door, the comedy house fits 357 people.
Yeah.
You pack it out. That's
right. That's a lot of money.
That's a good day.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So it's possible, but yeah, it's the money's got to be right, because it's like, I mean, you're making movies with Jackie Chan and they're selling. I mean, Rush Hour couldn't miss for like a while. Like, they really milked that fucking brand and series. And I don't know. I remember going to see Rush Hour 2 in the movies, and there was nothing but Black and Asian people in that fucking movie theater. And I didn't even know that many Asian people lived in Charlottesville, Virginia at that time, but it was packed out. So
besides that, you know how hard it is to make a good sequel?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, that's a great sequel. And you just like, you know, not a lot of people stick that landing, you know?
No, not a lot. And some people, they will go 7 series and it all sucked. And I'm like, but those are more of like cult classic suck movies. Like, they always suck, you know?
Oh, yeah, there's a lot of Saw 2s out there. no disrespect to people like Saw.
The Saw just like couldn't outdo the first one, because it was just so, you know, it makes such a left or whatever. It's like, you can't top that. Like, that was amazing, you know? Yeah. And like, so.
Yeah, how many people can lay on the floor and not breathe?
Right, yeah, and just like to like prove a point or do something. It's like, that's sinister, it's evil, and it was brilliant. And then to try to do stuff after that, it's like, all right, some of these games just don't make any fucking sense or whatever, you know what I mean?
Yeah, we went from being different to throw some more blood.
Right, just throw some more blood, put a weird clown in there or something like that, like just trying to come up with stuff.
1 through 10, what would you give Friday?
Is it just a movie or like a comedy?
Whichever, buddy.
Like, part of me wants to give it a 10 because of how like relevant it is in my life. But I think I'll give it a 9 just because, I don't know, like, actually, you know what? I'm going to give it 10 because it was a low budget movie and they worked so hard and like made it good. You know, that could have easily been like The Wash, you know, or like,
I Got the Hookups.
Any of the, yeah, I Got the Hookups or something like that. Like, no, this was like a really good comedy movie, and it was made and acted like, even Ice Cube did a good job like acting as like a guy that never really acted, you know, like that. So it was a 10 out of 10 top favorite movie.
We did talk about this earlier, but that is hilarious to find when you go back in time and realize this is the guy that made No Vaseline, you know.
And then like later on and like he's making all these like family movies and shit like that. Like, who would have thought the guy made like Fuck the Police is now like a Family Guy actor.
Him and Snoop Dogg. You'd be like, when did this happen?
When did Snoop become family friendly? Like a fucking crypt from Long Beach. It's like, you know, it's possible.
Very dumb question, but I have to ask. Do you believe that this movie has become a part of pop culture?
Oh, for sure. For sure. I think so many hood comedies was birthed out of that. I mean, even the stuff that the Wayans brothers would put on with Don't Be a Menace While Sipping Your Juice in the Hood or something like that, like those kind of like movies, like I said, The Wash, like those kind of movies. There's movies that I think like I think T.I. did with like
something. ATL?
It's like kind of like ATL, but like he made like some other silly one recently.
Oh, I've seen that. I've seen that.
Like, I think like DC Young Flies and that thing, like Lil Duval might be in it, you know.
They were talking about giving it a sequel. I hope not.
I remember it not really being that well. Won't it be funny like when we get like really successful and they play this clip back of us like shitting on like Lil Duval and DC Young Fly or something?
I can only imagine them being, but like, he ain't lying.
Right? Like, come on, the movie sucked. Like, come on. Like, it was a good try, you know. But yeah.
Yes. Well, man, thank you so much for coming on to the movie review. Is there anything you'd like to say to your fans? And please tell them about your podcast and also tell them where they can follow you.
Yeah, just follow me on Instagram at I am Brian O'Neill. Podcast is the Vicious Pineapple Podcast. Currently, we are in a rebrand, I would say, and just we're putting up some episodes, some old episodes, and we've been recording some new. So very shortly, we'll get like another rotation of like putting out content. But we've been kind of on a break for the last month or so because we had a situation go down that we had to address. And now that we've addressed it, we can move forward and put out some dope content. So yeah, check out Vicious Pineapple at I am Brian O'Neill. And thank you for having me on the podcast. Appreciate it.
No problem. Thank you guys so much for watching and listening. Have an amazing day.